So welcome everybody to the FCCJ. It's great to see so many people attending today. Jorge-san only has 1 hour, so I'll keep this pretty brief. Okay, my name is John Boyd, and I'm a freelance journalist. I write for IEEE Spectrum magazine. Going on to our speakers, as you noticed, it's a cloudy day, so probably not a great day for launching rockets, unless you operate in North Korea, perhaps. But we have two speakers today who will tell us a lot about how to launch rockets and why to launch rockets. Our main speaker has a dazzling, colorful resume, so much so that I actually brought along sunglasses to be able to read the resume, but the lighting is pretty good, so I don't think I do need them after all. As an entrepreneur and nonconformist, like so many other famous nonconformist entrepreneurs, he dropped out of university, Tokyo University. So just like Bill Gates or Steve Jobs or Larry Page, he's in that circle of entrepreneurs and nonconformists. He dropped out because he had started his own company in Tokyo University. So that was like a hint for the future, what he was about to do. He went on from there to start a very successful internet portal company called LiveDoor. Very successful, so much so that he branched out into other areas, like he wanted to buy a baseball team. Mm-hmm. He was even wanting to become a politician, I understand.
Yeah.
Yes. Fortunately, unfortunately for journalists here, they were not so successful. So he decided to take a 2.5 year sabbatical in sunny Nagano. There he made lots of friends. Some of those too were dropouts, but not as successful as our main speaker today. Which brings us now to our topic for today, interstellar technologies. He and our second speaker, Inagawa-san, will tell us why they think this is a good business to get into launching rockets for small satellites, and why they think it's going to be successful when so many other companies are looking to do the same. So ladies and gentlemen, let's give a big warm welcome to Jorge-san and Inagawa-san, Interstellar Technologies.
あ、皆さんこんにちは。IST のまあ創業者、であり取締役であるホレイです。今日はですね、サブオービタルロケットモモ、フライト3の、成功を受けまして、まあ世界でもそんなに数が多くない、ロケット打ち上げビジネスで、まあ、一つのマイルストーンを超えたということで、こちらの方で、まあ、将来構想も含めて、お話をしていきたいなと思ってます。ちなみにもう、ロケットビジネスに関して言うと、先ほどご紹介いただいたライブドア時代から、まあ、結構試行錯誤しながら投資をしていまして、多分資材で60億円以上投資をして、なんとかサブオービタルのロケット打ち上げまでたどり着いたということで、まあ、非常に感慨深いんですけれども、まあ、その辺について説明したいと思います。
So good afternoon, everybody. As introduced, I am the founder of IST, Interstellar Technologies, and I'm here today to speak to you, first of all, about the recent success of the launch of our suborbital rocket, Momo, the third, and also to share some information about our future steps as well. Of course, this recent success in the launch was an example of one of the few rocket businesses around the world that has been capable to do this, so it is, in some senses, a real milestone. In terms of the rocket business, as was mentioned during the introduction, this is something that I have actually started to be involved in since the LiveDoor days, working, shall we say, in a kind of trial and error towards this as well. I think I've probably invested close to 6 billion yen into this over the years as well. So it's very significant for me to look back over these years and think about having this success today.
本当は FCCJ さんにはカルロス・ゴーンの話をしろと言われてオファーを受けたんですけど、 ちょうどあのロケットの打ち上げが成功したんで、そちらの方でいいですかっていうところを快諾していただきました。この後あのまずあのムービーを見ていただいて、社長の稲川の方から、まあ、技術的な話も含めて、手短に、まあ、あのプレゼンテーション、してもらおうと思ってます。
And so first of all, I was asked by the FCCJ actually to speak about Carlos Ghosn today, considering my background. But I went back to them and asked instead, well, because we had this recent success of the rocket launch, if I could talk about this instead. And this was gratefully accepted. So I'm here to speak to you about this issue today. First of all, I'd like to show a brief movie in regards to this launch. And then I will pass over to our CEO, Mr. Inagawa, who will share some of the technical aspects about this recent launch in a brief presentation.
はい、それでは私の方からまず動画をご覧ください。
So first of all, please watch this video.
ちなみにこのカウントダウンの音声は初音ミク。
So this is 初音ミク doing the countdown to the launch actually.So this is at the moment when the rocket passed what is known as the Kármán line, or the 100 kilometer distance from the Earth, marking the entrance into space.
はい、我々インターステラテクノロジーズですけれども、小さいスタートアップでして、北海道大樹町を本店、東京にも支社があるという会社です。
So as Interstellar Technologies or IST, we are a small startup. We have our headquarters in the town of Taiki in Hokkaido, and we also have a branch office in Tokyo.
我々事業としては2つ行おうと考えております。1つ目がサブオービタルロケットであるモモで、もう1つがスモールローンチビークルであるゼロになります。
And so we have two main projects which we are working on. The first is the suborbital rocket Momo, and the second is a small launch vehicle Zero.
サブオービタルと、まあ、オービタル、まあ、ゼロの違いですけれども、100km のカーマンラインというところを超えるサブオービタルのロケット、これが今回成功したロケットです。
And so to explain the difference between the suborbital and the orbital rockets, the suborbital is referring to those which just exceed what is known as the Kármán line, as has been mentioned, the 100km mark from the Earth's surface, marking the entrance into space.
このオービタルロケットであるゼロは地球低軌道といわれる高度 500km のところを地球周回する予定のロケットです。
And the orbital rocket, as is mentioned here, refers to those orbital launch vehicles which will go to an altitude of 500km at the low Earth orbit and orbit the Earth from there.
これまで我々このモモの打ち上げの前に2011年から大樹町北海道でこれまで13回の打ち上げ実験を行ってきました。
And to date we have actually carried out 13 launch attempts from Taiki in Hokkaido from 2011, and the details of these, this history is, illustrated here.
2017年にはモモ初号機フライト1の打ち上げを行いました。こちらは部分的成功、パーシャルサクセスというふうに考えております。
And so in 2007 we had the first launch of the Momo Number One, and this was a partial success.
はい。このモモ初号機では、66秒、打ち上げ後66秒にですね、一番空気の濃いところであるマックス Q と。 言われるところで、壊れてしまったというふうに考えています。
And so in regards to the Momo F1, this partial success in 2017, after liftoff 66 seconds after liftoff is when it, had the accident. It was estimated that this happened as it was in what is known as Max Q, and unfortunately, it was not successful following this.
2号機は2018年去年、打ち上げを行いました。これは打ち上げに失敗して、打ち上げ後すぐに落下炎上するということになりました。
And in regards to、the Momo F2、last year at the launch attempt, unfortunately this was a failure and it、ended、unsuccessfully.
まあでもね、これ爆発炎上した映像が、あまりにも綺麗だったので皮肉なことに世界20カ国以上の、もう CNN とかそういったメジャーなメディアも含む、ところで報道されて不幸にも有名になってしまいました。
And so while it did end with this explosion, actually the video of this moment was something rather beautiful. And so this was actually reported by more than 20 international media, including CNN and so on, these major outlets. So while it was not successful in terms of the launch, it did, well, within this actually result in making us rather famous.
はい、この2号機の失敗を受けて、原因究明を行いました。で、この10ヶ月後にですね、3号機を打ち上げるということになりました。
And so following, the Momo F2 failure, we investigated the causes in what resulted in this, and then 10 months later, we were able to have the next, launch attempt.
このモモ3号機についての概要ですけれども、ここ、まあ、リストに載せている通りですね、大きな特徴としては液体ロケットであると。というところ、あとエタノールと液体酸素のロケットであるというのが大きな特徴です。
And the details or the specifications of the Momo F3 are listed on this slide, but the two particular characteristics I would like to draw attention to is first that it is a liquid rocket, and second that the propellant used is ethanol and liquid oxygen.
2号機から3号機への変更点ですけれども、設計の変更としてですね、まあ、配管パイプの、まあ、設計の変更、インジェクターの変更という、まあ、技術的な変更を行ったというところです。
And in regards to the changes between the second and third models, there were various engineering or technical changes which were made to this, including a change in the piping and also the injector.
我々民間企業でロケットをやっているということで、こうロケットの外装にスポンサーさんの名前、企業名を載せるということおよびネーミングライツの販売ということを行って打ち上げを行ったところです。
And as a private company, when we are creating these rockets and launching them, we are selling to sponsors the naming rights and also the branding or the design actually on the rocket itself.
今回この3号機にはペイロードとして、高知工科大学のインフラサウンドセンサーという、まあ、サイエンスの実験のものと、もう一つはグロースバル社というところのハンバーグをの搭載していました。
And as for the payload which was on the Momo 3, there were two items. The first was in regards to a well, scientific experiment with the Kochi University of Technology, and that was an infrasound sensor which was in the payload. And the second was a hamburger from Grossball.
スポンサーと同時にですね、クラウドファンディングによって開発資金の調達というのを行いました。
And as well as sponsorship, we have also raised funds through crowdfunding.
でこの3号機の実験としては高度 100km カーマンラインというところを超えてフルサクセスという結果でした。
And as a result, the test of the Momo F3 was a full success. It exceeded the Kármán line, the 100km mark, and to enter into space.
でこのモモの成功を受けてですね、まずは一つこのモモを量産化して商業化していく、定常的に打ち上げていくということを行おうと考えています。
And as a next step, we are looking at how to commercialize this rocket and to be able to really regularly conduct such launches.
で、その次の段階として、小型衛星を打ち上げるゼロというロケットの開発を行っているところです。
And the next step is conducting development in order to be able to launch small launch vehicle zero with satellites.
これは100kgのものをですね、100kgのペイロードを高度550キロ、500キロメートルですね、 太陽同期軌道 SSO というところに打ち上げるというものです。
And so the small launch vehicle Zero will be looking at having a payload of up to 100 kilograms and traveling at an altitude of 500 kilometers from the Earth, so at a low Earth orbit.
大きさとしてモモより長さで2倍以上、直径として3倍以上大きいサイズになります。
And in regards to the size, it will be two times approximately the length of the Momo and three times the diameter of the Momo as well.
このMomoからゼロでの大きな変更点、もちろんサイズは違うんですけれども、大きな点としてはターボポンプとエンジンをクラスタリングするというところがまず違います。
And as well as, of course, the size difference between the Momo and the Zero, there will also be changes in regards to also having a turbo pumps and also cluster engines.
もう一つは、Momo が一段ロケットに対してゼロは二段ロケットであるという点も違います。
And there's also a difference in that the Zero will be a second stage rocket in respect to the Momo being a first.
逆にですね、Momo で実証できた点っていうのも非常に多くあるというふうに考えています。
And at the same time, however, there are many points which have been verified or proven through the Momo launch.
大きな点としては、まあ、インハウス、我々が自社で開発している液体ロケットエンジン。
The first and significant point is that the rocket engine is an in-house developed rocket engine, liquid rocket engine.
またエンジンと同時に電子部品、アビオニクスと呼ばれますけれども、ロケット用の電子部品も社内で内製しています。
And another further important point is that the avionics or the electronic devices which are part of this are also developed in-house.
はい。また北海道の工場の方でロケットの構造も作っていますけれども、これも大きさは違いますけれども、Momoとゼロも社内で内製していくという点では一緒です。
And as well as this, similarly to Momo, the fabrication of the rocket itself is also conducted in our own factory in Hokkaido. So this is also in-house.
また打ち上げ場所として北海道大樹町の打ち上げ場所を使うという点でも一緒になります。
And we will also be utilizing the same launch site in Taiki in Hokkaido.
で今我々この観測ロケットのモモ打ち上げ成功したことによって最初の一歩を踏み出せたと考えております。
And so we believe that with the success of the Momo launch recently, we have now really entered or taken the first big step.
モモは宇宙空間に出るということが、まあ、できたことですけれども、その次セカンドステップとしては地球の周りを回る人工衛星にするというゼロがある。
And so the Momo has been successful in entering space. However, we see as the next step, the Zero will be not only entering space, but also traveling in orbit around the Earth with satellites.
我々が開発しているのは液体ロケットですので、ロケットを大型化するということが、まあ、比較的容易なものになっています。
And because the rockets which we are developing are liquid rockets, this also means that to develop larger rockets is also relatively a simple process.、
はい、まあ、それによって、第3段階としてロケット、まあ、ゼロより大きいものを作り、ディープスペース、新宇宙、まあ、月、火星、小惑星、そういうところに探査をするということも考えております。
And therefore, we see as the third step looking at developing large launch vehicles or rockets, which can then bring us into further exploration of deep space or the moon and planets and so on.
その後はですね、ディープスペース、いわゆる太陽圏内の探査の後は、我々社名でもあるインターステラ、恒星間、星と星の間ですけれども、そういうところまで行くような技術の開発っていうのを行いたいというふうに考えています。
And then we see as the next step for our company beyond this, after the deep space exploration, is as is in our company name, interstellar exploration as well. So flights in the interstellar regions.
はい、私からの発表は以上です。
So that's all from me.
じゃあ、あと最後に僕から、補足説明をさせていただきます。
So I would like to add a few additional explanations.
これまで宇宙開発というのは政府主導で行われてきました。このせいで何が起こってたかというと、政府の科学技術予算等で、ロケットが作られる場合、やはりその最高の性能のもの、新規の技術開発を伴うもの、こういったものに投資が、されてきました。
And so I would like to share some of the difference in terms of the developments in the space business. Until now, developments in the space field have been led by governments. As a result of this, this means that according to government budget allocation and so on for science and space science, this means that this budget is allocated towards, for example, those with the highest specifications or the most recent, most new developments.
なのでどうしてもその高いロケットを作ってしまう傾向があって、単に宇宙に行くだけだったら実は1940年代に開発された、ドイツの V2 ロケット、まあ、実は我々の、この間打ち上げたロケットってのはその V2 ロケットと同じようなスペックなんですけれども、それでも十分要は70年以上前の技術で、実は、宇宙には行けちゃうんですね。
And this means, of course, that the trend is really to very expensive rocket development as well. However, if we think about what kind of rockets are needed just to go into space, actually the technology, even from the 1940s, from the German V2s, for example, is sufficient to be able to have rockets which can actually enter space as well. So this technology from 70 years ago, which is actually in some way similar to what we are using in our rockets, is enough to bring things into space.
ですので我々の、まあ、民間企業である、メリットというのは、安くて、宇宙に行ける最低性能のロケットを作ることができる。それによって、実は宇宙開発の実は障害になっているのは、価格だったということに、まあ、我々は注目していて、ここで価格破壊を起こすことによって、宇宙をより身近に宇宙に物とか人を、たくさん送り込めることが可能になるというふうに考えて、この事業をやってます。
And so the merit of our initiative as a private company is that we can make things much more cheaper using the minimum kind of technology which is necessary to go to space. What has really been a barrier to space development until now has been the high costs. So we have noted this point, paid attention to this, and looking at how to break that down, how to bring it less, so that we can make the act of bringing people or items into space much more closer and much more possible.
まあ、我々のライバルで、ライバルというのもおこがましいんですけど、スペース X だったり、ブルーオリジン、バージンギャラクティック、あと、ロケットラボ、こういった会社が先行してるんですけれども、この軌道投入機ゼロを打ち上げ成功すれば、彼らとまあ、技術的には、肩を並べる、会社になることができます。
And so if we compare with, for example, our rivals, well, whether I should call them our rivals or not, but those companies like SpaceX, Blue Origin, Virgin Galactic, or Rocket Lab, who are really leading this field, well, if we are able to be successful in the launch of the orbital rocket Zero, then we will actually be up on the same starting line as these different companies from a technical perspective.
で、まあ、先ほど稲川の方から紹介した通り、この間打ち上げ成功したモモと、ゼロの間に、まあ、新規開発しなければいけない、技術要素はあるんですけれども、まあ、制御だったりとか構造を作ったりとかそういった、軌道投入機に必要な技術の、まあ、一部はすでに我々習得しているので、ゼロから軌道投入機を開発するよりは、ものすごい速いスピードで、キャッチアップできると思いますので、本当にまあ、2、3年というタイムスパンで我々は軌道投入機を宇宙に運ぶことになると思います。
And as Mr. Inagawa has said, well, there is some new technological developments which will need to be made between the success of Momo and the launch of Zero. Overall, the same structures and so on can really be maintained in this sense. So we already do have a certain amount of the capacity towards the technology for an orbital rocket as well. We are not developing this from scratch, from zero, from now as well. Therefore, I believe that we will be able to catch up very fast in this respect and we'll be able to launch such an orbital zero in a time span of around 2 to 3 years.
で、実はロケットは小型ロケットの方が面倒くさくて作るのが大変なところが結構あるんですけど、なので逆に言うと大型化の方が小さいものを作って大型化する方が割と簡単というか、まあ、そこは じゃあなんで大きいの作らないのかって言われると、お金があんまり、資金がちょっと足りないからできないんですけれども。
And so actually it's quite difficult to make these smaller rockets. It can be rather fiddly and sort of technically very difficult for this. However, to shift this development into a larger rocket is something which is actually not so difficult. Well, you may ask, well, why are we not making larger rockets from now then? And this is, well, for the fact that it takes more funds also to do this.
あの皆さんにたくさん報道していただいて、お金がたくさん集まるといいなと思ってます。
So we hope that you can report a lot more about our work, and we can also therefore raise more funds in that way as well.
あともう一つ、補足しますと、これ日本というのは世界的に見て、ロケット打ち上げに、ロケットの製造と打ち上げにものすごく向いている地域なんですね。
And one more point I would like to add that is that even looking globally, Japan is actually very suited to both fabrication and also launch of rockets.
なぜなら、ロケットというのは例えば、ISS とか、にロケット打ち上げる場合、東側に打つんですけれども、なぜ東側に打つかというと、地球の自転のエネルギーを、使うからなんですね。
And the reason for this is actually if we look at, for example, launches of, well, for example, the International Space Station and so on, this is actually towards the east, and this is for the reason of the Earth's, directional aspects.
ちなみに、それは後でいい。あともう一つ、そのさっき我々が言った SSO っていう軌道で打ち上げるのは、例えば地球観測衛星であったり偵察衛星であったり、例えば Google Earth とかで、地球 の, 写真を皆さん見ることができると思うんですけど、そういうのは SSO に打ち上げるんですね。
And as well as you said, we mentioned the SSO before as well, but this is if we look at, for example, sounding rockets or those which are used for, bringing images, for example, you know, Google Earth, everybody being able to look at images from the Earth as a result of this, this is actually based on this SSO.
なので、ロケットというのは通常東か北か南に打つんですよ。
And so usually rockets are launched towards either the east or the north or south.
なので日本は東も南も、太平洋で人が住んでませんので、ほとんど、なので、ロケットを安全に、どんどん打ち上げることが可能な非常に恵まれた地域なんですね。
And Japan of course has to its east and south the Pacific Ocean where there are relatively few people living. Therefore it's actually a very safe place to carry out frequent launches as well. So we're very blessed in terms of this environment.
だから、本当にハンディキャップを抱えている国っていくつかあって、例えば先ほど司会の方がおっしゃってた北朝鮮とかまさにそうで、彼らがロケットを打ち上げようとしたら必ず日本の領空を飛ばなければいけないと。なので毎回大騒ぎになると。
And therefore there are though of course some countries which are in very difficult, geographic location which have this kind of handicap for launches. The moderator mentioned, North Korea. But of course when North Korea wants to launch a rocket, this will automatically comes over the direction of Japanese airspace which brings a, well, big issue about it.
で、もう一つ大きなところがあって、ロケットに使われているセンサーとか、ハイテクの素材だったりとか、そういった例えば、CFRP とか、そういった素材、あるいはそのロケットを製造するのに使う工作機械だったりとか、こういったものは、軍事転用が容易なので、輸出規制、厳しい輸出規制がかかってます。しかしながら我々は日本という場所にいるので、すべての部品が日本国内で手に入ります。つまり厳しい輸出規制、輸出入の規制を、が関係ないってことですね。
And one other significant factor is when we consider, for example, the sensors or high-tech materials such as CFRP or the machinery and so on, which is used in the development of rockets. Many of these are actually, well, dual use, which can be easily transferred for military use as well. Therefore, there are many export restrictions on these kinds of parts and machinery and materials and so on. However, in the case of Japan, all of these parts are available domestically, which means that these kinds of restrictions are not a factor for us.
恵まれた国は実は世界に、おそらく僕は思うに2カ国しかなくて、日本とアメリカなんですね。
And I believe that there are probably only two countries in the world which have, or enjoy these kind of factors, and that would be Japan and the United States.
だから僕はその日本政府としても、ロケット産業を、重点的な投資、 分野に位置づけて、もっと産業振興を進めた方がいいと思うし、ロケットはまあ、言ったミサイルと一緒なので、激しい輸出規制がかかってますので、まあ、外に持ち出すのがなかなか難しいので、必ずその国内、まあ、日本国内で打ち上げサービスをすると、つまり例えば東南アジアの国から衛星打ち上げたいんですけどって言って、その東南アジアの国にロケットそのものを輸出することはできないので、事実上まあできないので、日本に衛星を持ってきて日本から打ち上げる、つまり日本で打ち上げサービスを行うということが大きなビジネスになり税収につながるので、ぜひそういったところも日本政府にはお力添えをいただきたいなというふうに思っています。
And I believe that actually if the Japanese government were to place a very focused increased investment in the rocket industry, this could make a great impact as well. Rockets, of course, use the same technology as missiles, meaning that there are these very severe export restrictions and so on. It's very difficult to bring them to another country. So if we looked at the potential of having rocket launch services being provided in Japan, there is a great opportunity there. For example, if there is a country in Southeast Asia who wants to launch a satellite, it's not possible, of course, to bring a rocket to that country. So if Japan can offer these kinds of launch services of satellites and so on, this can be a very big business chance for Japan and also lead to great tax revenue and so on as well. So I hope that the Japanese government can really put its efforts towards that.
先行するアメリカでは、NASA 経由で、巨額の予算が先行投資されてて、その結果としてスペース X とかロケットラボのような有力なベンチャー企業が成功しつつあるというところを考えても、これは日本にとってはめちゃくちゃ大きなチャンスなんじゃないかなというふうに思ってます。
And if we look at what has progressed in the United States, which is ahead in this respect, as a result of a huge investment of budget on the part of NASA, this has meant for real success in the strong ventures such as SpaceX and Rocket Lab, for example. Therefore, I think that this is really a huge chance for Japan as well.
以上です。
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Great. Now we'll turn it over to the press first. Please, give your name and your association, and we'll begin with questions. Go ahead.
Süddeutsche Zeitung Neidhardt. The airplane that Tokutai used, the kamikaze, was called Zero. Now you call your launcher Zero. Is that intentional or is that an unhappy coincidence?
特攻隊が使っていた飛行機もゼロ戦という飛行機だったんですけれども、それ意図的に同じ名前を使っているのか、もしくは偶然ということでしょうか。何か意味はありますでしょうか。
多分全然違っていて、僕がそれこそ長野に2年間ねバカンスに行ってたってご紹介いただきましたけど、その後に6年前に、書いた本の名前がゼロでして、ゼロから1を作るっていうことが、いかに難しいか、でどんなに人間は失敗しても、ゼロにしかならない、マイナスにはならないみたいなお話を書いてる本があるんですけど、これはベストセラーになって、ここから割と付けられてる名前だと思います。
It's completely unrelated to that. As the moderator mentioned that I had a sabbatical for 2 years in Nagano, but actually 6 years ago I wrote a book which was titled Zero. And this was talking about the difficulty of creating things from zero, but also the fact that all humans make mistakes, but no matter how many mistakes they make, how many things can happen, it will only return to zero. It will not go into minus, for example. This book was a bestseller, and so this title of Zero and the name of the rocket Zero is coming from this background rather than as was mentioned.
Yes, go ahead.
Hello, Thomas Davidson, foreign correspondent for the Jutland Post, a Danish newspaper. SpaceX has become very famous for its reusable rocket technology. There was recently a reusable rocket fired and relanded in China. Blue Origin is also looking into the technology. The idea being that it's, excuse me, a huge cost saver. Is that something you'll be looking into?
のデンマークの記者です。まあ、スペース X がですね、非常に有名になったのが、その何回も利用できるロケットの開発、再利用できるロケットの開発、そしてその技術ということなんですけれども、ブルーオリジンも確かそういったような開発をされているというようなことも言われています。そのコストの削減というのは非常に大きな理由なんですけれども、将来的にそういったことも検討されていますでしょうか。
これからコストの削減にリユーザブルロケットはそんなに寄与しないというふうに我々は考えていて、なぜなら、まあ、一つの理由として、使い捨て、まあ、今の主流であるディスポーザブルのロケットっていうのは、大量生産が可能なんですね。打ち上げを例えば年に50回とか100回とかやると、例えばエンジンになると、うちの軌道導入機で1回につき10個使うんで、例えば1000本とかのロケットを、生産できるようになると、割と量産効果が効いてきて、ロケットエンジンの製造コストとかそういったものは、安くなると考えてます。
In regards to the cost issue and reusable technology, reusable rockets being a cost saver, we do not actually think that way at our company. The main reason for this is, well, currently the mainstream is these, well, shall we say, disposable rockets, but these can be mass produced. So for example, it can look towards 50 or even 100 launches per year. Looking at the engines as well, it can be on 1 per 10, for example. So this can mean even a production of 1,000 rockets in the year as well. Therefore, the fact that these disposable rockets can be produced in this mass way, we believe that overall actually the cost is lower than developing these so-called reusable rockets.
多分みんな世界最大の失敗作と言われるロケット、スペースシャトルのことをすでにもうお忘れのようですが、当初スペースシャトルもリユーザブルにしてものすごい大きなコストダウンができるというふうに喧伝してたはずなんですけど、蓋を開けてみたら、使い捨てのロケットよりもめちゃくちゃコストが上がって、安さという意味では使い物にならなかったという事実があります。
And perhaps many of you have forgotten what has been the greatest failure in rocket development or launches until now, the space shuttle. This was really being presented as, because it being reusable, being a huge reduction in cost. However, if you look at what actually the situation was, what actually happened, there was a huge increase in the costs compared to disposable rockets as well. Therefore, it did not really serve any purpose at all, actually, cost, from the cost perspective.
なぜ再利用ロケットがコストダウンできないかっていうと、まあ、一つは何回も使うので頑丈に作らなければいけない、頑丈に作らなければいけないということは重くなるってことなんで、その重いのを打ち上げるために性能を上げなければいけない、性能を上げようとすると、技術的に結構難しいところがたくさん出てきて、高い部品をたくさん使わなければいけない、しかもリユーザブルなので量産できない、ロケットなんて多分10本もあれば、何回もそれを繰り返して使うんであればもうそれ以上製造する必要がないので、一点一点多分すごく高くなる。でさらに再整備のコストが、1回打ち上げるごとにロケット多分オーバーホールして、検査をしなければいけないので、再整備のコストもすごく重くなる。なのであんまり安くならないというふうに僕たちは考えている。せいぜい3分の1ぐらいのコストにしかならないと思っています。
And so why is it that these reusable rockets are not actually do not lead to a decrease in cost? Well, one reason is that in order to use it many times, it needs to be much sturdier, shall we say, in terms of the actual construction of it. Therefore, it means that it is also much heavier. To launch a rocket which is much heavier, of course, it needs much higher specs on top of that as well. And there are many technical difficulties in terms of such development. Very expensive parts need to be included, for example. The other factor is that such reusable rockets cannot be produced in volume, cannot be mass produced in this way as well. Therefore, there may be, well, 10 rockets produced, and that might be enough to serve the purposes of that. However, the cost for the development of each one of those rockets would be much, much higher as well. A further extra cost as well would be in regards to the maintenance. After each launch, even if it can be reused again, it would need to be overhauled, have significant inspections and so on, and there are very high costs incurred in that process as well. Therefore, we do not think that there would be such a huge reduction in the cost, and maximum maybe one third.
おそらく彼らはコストダウンのために 再利用をやってるのではなくて、おそらくですけど、スペース X は火星探査を予定してますし、ブルーオリジンは先日月、の探査を発表しましたけど、その時に、リエントリーって言って、火星とかその月に着陸をしなきゃいけないんですけど、その時の技術とすごく似てるんですね、あの技術って。多分その技術を習得するために、そういったことをやってんじゃないかなとか思ってます。
And actually, we think that probably the most likely reason that these companies such as SpaceX and Blue Origin are putting their resources into reusable rockets is not actually for this cost factor, but more for technical reasons as well. They are, of course, looking at various exploration, looking at the moon or Mars and so on as well. Therefore, the re-entry technology is a significant point in regards to this, whether you are looking at the moon or Mars and so on. The similar technology is needed for these reusable rockets or also the re-entry in those kinds of explorations as well. Therefore, we think that it's probably likely that this development is actually more for these purposes, looking at these technical developments rather than actually for the cost benefits.
Yes, go ahead. Yeah.
Martin Kölling, Handelsblatt from Germany. Two questions. First, just a clarification. You showed your timeline. Can you also put some times to the line? So when do you think you can reach each of the milestones? This is my first question. And then I would like to ask both of you to share your background in rocket engineering and your motivation to start this company.
2つほど質問があります。まず1つ目はこちらの方でその、これからの目標というスライドがあったんですけれども、それにつくタイムラインのようなものをもし教えていただければと思います。それぞれの目標をいつまでに達成しようとしているのかということをまず教えていただければということです。そして2つ目のお二人に質問したいんですけれども、まずこのロケットの科学ですね、その技術などどういった背景をお持ちなのか、どういった今はそのロケットに関する経験があるのかということ、そしてそのモチベーションの方ですね、このロケット開発に関するモチベーションの方も教えていただければということが2つ目です。
はい、まずこのタイムラインについてですけれども、今スライドに出している通りですね、今サボビタルのモモができています。でこのゼロの打ち上げについてですけれども、これは 2,3 年のうちにというところですので、2022年の末から23年に初打ち上げを行いたいというふうに考えています。
So first of all, in regards to the timeline, we are now just having achieved the successful first step, the suborbital Momo, and we are looking towards the second step now for the Zero, which we see to be launching in 2 to 3 years, so around the end of 2022 to sometime in 2023 for the first launch.
そこから開発としてもですね、ゼロの打ち上げの後量産当然やっていくわけですけれども、同時並行で次のディープスペースに行けるような一回り大きいロケットの開発っていうのも、これも数年、2、3、4年というそういうタイムスパンで開発完成させたいと考えています。
And so from when we foresee the successful launch of Zero, of course there will go into the further production of that, but the development for the large launch vehicle we see as taking perhaps 2, 3, 4 years from there. So from the time of the successful launch of Zero, between 2 to 4 years for the large launch vehicle.
このインターステラフライトについては先の技術になるので、これはここからの技術開発がどこまで進むかというところで時間はかなり変わってくるとは思います。
And in regards to if we go towards the fifth step, the interstellar flight, of course this will be largely dependent on the kind of technical developments which will happen in the coming years as well. So we see this as somewhat in the future depending upon that.
この話インターステラの部分に関して言うと、新しい、結構最先端の技術開発になると思うので、それこそ JAXA とかそういったところと協力して、みたいな感じになってくると思うし、彼らの、その実験宇宙船みたいなものを我々が安価に打ち上げられるようになって、打ち上げの機会が増えれば増えるほど技術開発は多分加速するんですね。今は H2 で何回？
年3回か。
年3回、イプシロン1回ぐらい。
2年に1回。
2年に1回か。ぐらいしか打ち上げ機会がないので、 1年にたった 2,3 回の、まあ、さらにそこに偵察衛星なんかが入ったりするんで、本当2回とか3回ぐらいの打ち上げ機会で、例えば有名なはやぶさ2とかの開発および運用を行ってるんですけれども、この宇宙に行く機会がものすごく増えれば、そういった最先端技術開発も進むと思うので、割と僕は加速するんじゃないかな、割と意外と早い段階でインターステラフライトまで行けんじゃないかと思ってます。
And in regards to the interstellar flight, of course, this is something where we would also look for cooperation with JAXA, the Japan Aerospace Exploration Agency, and so on as well. Looking at, for example, cooperation in terms of the launches or anchoring on our side and so on. However, we would need to have also more opportunities for launches in order to develop this latest technology, which is required to develop further into interstellar flight. For example, if we look at the number of launches which JAXA is carrying out now, it is, for example, two a year for the Hayabusa 2 or one every 2 years for the Epsilon. So if we think of this as, well, only two or three per year, for example, the chances for the launch to actually go further and develop this technology much more significantly is rather few. So as we are looking at having more chances to go to space, more chances to conduct such launches as well, this will also greatly accelerate the speed of the development of this kind of required technology as well. So I believe that actually the timing for this development towards interstellar flight will really become much faster in the years to come.
で、技術的な、まあ、どうやって安価にするロケットかという観点ですけれども、重要な点は2点あると思っています。で、1つ目がエンジンの技術ですね。特に重要なのがインジェクター、燃料の噴射するところですけれども、ここに我々はピントル型インジェクター、ピントルタイプインジェクターというのを用いています。
And in regards to the technical side of things, how this is anchored, there are two specific important points. First is in regards to the engine technology and especially the injector, and we are using a pintle type injector for this.
このピントル型インジェクターという技術はアポロ計画の月着陸船に使われていた技術でもあります。非常に安くこの噴射器が作れる方法として我々は注目して、まあ、そういうアポロ計画の文献からですね、まあ、ある意味リバースエンジニアリングをして、このモモの開発およびゼロの開発をやっているというところです。
And this pintle type technology is actually based from the Apollo plans and the moon landing and so on as well. It's rather cheap actually to produce in regards to this. So we are looking at the various literature and research and so on remaining from that and reverse engineering in order to use this technology in the Momo and Zero.
もう一つ重要な観点がアビオニクス、電子部品です。これは、まあ、例えば、このモモに使われているジャイロセンサー、姿勢を測るセンサーなんかはドローンなどに使われているメムス、半導体のジャイロを用いています。非常に安価なものを用いていて、既存のロケットで使われているようなそのセンサーに対してだいたい2桁値段が低いものなんかを使っています。
And a second important point is in regards to the avionics or the electronic parts which go onto this as well, particularly the gyro sensors. The gyro sensors which we're using are based on what is actually being used in drones and so on as well, and based on this kind of technology related to semiconductors as well, it's actually about two figures cheaper than the existing rocket similar technology.
まあこのジャイロセンサー一つの例ですけれども、他の部品に関しても他の分野で使われている部品を積極的に、まあ例えば車に使われてる部品なんかを積極的に採用することによって、自社で宇宙用に新たに開発することなく安い電子部品が作れるような技術を持っています。
And so with this example of the gyro sensors for as one example, we are using for parts which are used in other fields, in other machines and so on, for example, even in automobiles, and re-engineering towards this using for rockets rather than looking at creating from scratch ourselves these different parts. Therefore, we are able to keep the costs very much down as a result of that.
まあ、お二人のモチベーションと、まあ、個人的な背景といいますか、そのロケット技術について、まあ
はい、まあ、私自身は学生の時に、まあ、スペース X だったり、まあ、他の会社もいくつか宇宙のスタートアップが出てきたタイミングで学生として見ていて、やはり まあ、アメリカで民間企業のビジネスが成功しそうなタイミングを見て、その後このインターステラという会社に入りましたけれども、まあ、アメリカでこう立ち上がってくるビジネスというのは数年遅れて日本でも必ず遅れてくるということもありますので、日本でも間違いなくこの民間ビジネスというのが立ち上がってくるだろうというところは感じていました。まあ、そういうところから誰かやらないと宇宙開発進まないので、それは自分たちでやっていこうと、まあ、特にロケットの部分が変わると宇宙開発全部が大きく変わるので、まあそういうところを新しく作っていこうというモチベーションでやっています。
And in regards to motivation, at the time when I was a student was actually the time when startups such as SpaceX were really looking like they were about to hit success. So looking at this stage which the private companies in the United States were entering in, well that was the kind of environment which is at the time when I entered the company of Interstellar Technologies, really during that period. Usually it's the case when businesses like this are successful in the US, they come to Japan several years later. So I was really looking at this and thinking that, well, sometime in the next few years, that has to start here in Japan as well. And if nobody else is going to be doing this, well, let's go ahead and let's develop this ourselves as well. If there can be progress in the rocket development, this will have a huge impact also on all space development as well. So this was what really led me to the motivation to work towards creating this.
僕の方は僕も今46歳なんですけど、僕は子供の頃すで、に、生まれる僕は生まれる前に、アポロで、人類は月に行ってましたし、宇宙戦艦ヤマトとか機動戦士ガンダムとか、2001年宇宙の旅とか、いろんな SF 映画アニメが僕は大人になる頃にはみんな気軽に宇宙に行けるようになってるというふうに、まあ、喧伝をしてたわけですけど、実際にはそうならなかったと。どうしてなってないんだろうなというのを、大人になって考えたら、あ、これはコストが高いから行けないんだってことに気づきまして、それから、まあ、自分で IT の会社を立ち上げて、それなりの資金力がついたので、宇宙分野への投資を始めようと。僕が安いロケットを作って、飛ばせばいいんだということで、始めたんですけど、なかなか試行錯誤しまして、結局自分たちでロケットエンジンを作らないと、それが達成できないことに気づきまして、2006年ぐらいからロケットを自前で一から作り始めて今に至るという感じですね。
And in my case, I'm now 46 years old. Of course, since I was a child, or rather even before I was born, was when, well, people reached the moon on the Apollo mission. And then there was, of course, the Yamato Gundam 2001, A Space Odyssey, really seeing all these science fiction movies and animations and so on that made me expect that by the time I would grow up, by the time I would be an adult, then people would be easily traveling into space. However, of course, when I became an adult and this didn't happen, I started to think, well, why was that? Why was it that we had and developed to that, and I realized that it was because of the high costs involved. After I had launched my own IT company and was able to have a certain amount of funds and capital available, I thought, well, it was time to start investing in the space field as well. First, we were looking at how to develop cheap rockets as the start, but through this process of trial and error and so on, we realized that in order to succeed in this, we needed to be able to develop our own engines as well. Therefore, it was from around 2016 that we started to really create from scratch our own rockets.
Yes, go ahead.
My name is Patrick Welter, I'm newspaper Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung. I have two questions, if I may. Uriya-san, when do you think that this endeavor will be economically or commercially viable? When might that be a profitable company, and what customers do you think you would get?And the second question is, even if you would like to talk about your rockets, but maybe you, if you like to, could you share your thoughts on the Gon case with us as well, please?
はい、ドイツの記者です。2つほど質問です。まず1つ目、ロケットに関してなんですけれども、こういったものが、まあ、経済的に、まあ、商業化できる、まあ、そして、まあ、利益も生まれるような、まあ、タイムラインはいつ頃というふうに考えられているのか、また、その時の顧客、まあ、お客さんはどういった会社、または、まあ、どういったお客
さんになるのかということについてまず教えていただければです。そして2つ目の質問、本日あのロケットがメインなんですけれども、もしあの可能でしたらゴーン氏のケースについてもしコメントいただければということです。
あの、はい、1つ目の質問はあのもうすでにあのサブオービタルのロケットモモの方については商用化できているというふうに考えてます。あの、まあ、1回あたりの、打ち上げ、で、まあ、いろんな会社さんがスポンサーで機体の例えば広告ですね、打ち上げる時の機体の広告だったりネーミングライツ、そして、みんなのこう思いを宇宙に届けようみたいな、クラウドファンディング、まあ、そして、真面目なあの科学技術の、まあ、実験をするためのペイロード、あるいは先ほど の, あのハンバーグのような、宇宙に行った何々シリーズみたいな、そういったものだったりとか、そういったところがクライアントさんになって、まあ、1回あたりの打ち上げで数千万円の売り上げが立ってますので、あのここの事業に関しては商業化が始まってるというふうに言って問題ないと思います。
In regards to the first question, for the case of Momo, the suborbital Momo, I think actually it's already succeeded in the commercialization and having a profit possible from this as well. For each of these launches, we have sponsors, for example, who are placing their advertisements on the rocket itself, who are paying for the naming rights of the rockets, and also crowdfunding, where, well, everyday people can also put in to have some of their wishes being brought to space, shall we say, as well. As well as this, of course, there is in regards to the payload, the first aspect of Sirius technological experiments and so on being carried out through this payload, but also as in the example of the hamburger commercializing, for example, a series of the something something that went to space, you know, in this commercial sense as well. Therefore, in regards to there are several different clients who are already existing in regards to these Momo, the Momo, and we think that this has already reached the possibility. It's actually in the well tens of millions of the investment which is already happening in regards to the Momo already. So that's successful in that respect.
まあ、でその後の、まあ、あの 2,3 年後に軌道投入機ゼロを打ち上げたらさらに顧客は大きく広がると思ってまして、まあ、それこそ、例えばワンウェブとかあのような衛星コンステレーションを作ってブロードバンドインターネット接続をするような会社の、どちらかというと僕たちはあの故障した衛星の、そのオルタナティブ、まあ、あの代わりに新しいその故障してないロケあの衛星を打ち上げるとかそういう補充の需要だったりとか、あるいはあのさっき、まあ、JAXA とか NASA とかが、開発している最先端技術を宇宙で試すための衛星だったりとか、まあ、そういったあの真面目な用途でも、たくさん使われると思いますし、それ以外に、エンターテインメントの需要も僕たちが考えてないようなことを、考えるような会社さんがいると思うので、例えば分かんないけど月にロンギヌスの槍をあの突き刺すプロジェクトとかっていうのは、まあ、これクラウドファンディングでお金集めてた団体があったんですけど、例えばそういったものを打ち上げたりとか、まあ、そういうこうインターネットもそうでしたけど、最初はあのみんな NASA のホームページとか見てたと思うんですけど、今やもういろんなことをインターネット上で皆さんやるようになってると思うんですけど、宇宙もそういう時代が来るだろうなと思ってます。
And in regards to if we look two or three years later when we're able to successfully launch the Orbital Zero, I believe that the client base will very much expand in regards to that. There is, of course, looking at the launch of satellites for the purposes of broadband internet, for example. We think that a big chance there is rather than launching new ones, looking at launching satellites for a replacement for satellites which have broken, for example, and sort of a complementary need. We see a very large chance there as well. Also collaborating with places or agencies such as JAXA or NASA, for example, in launching for their latest technology to carry out experiments and tests and so on. So there are these various serious purposes for this as well. However, there are of course many other sort of entertainment purposes we think that will be likely for this, which perhaps we are not even thinking about. There are probably companies which have many of different ideas which will be raised from now and raised as well, which can be incorporated as some of the clients there as well. And so when we look at, compare this to the internet, for example, when that first launched, probably people were just using it to look at the NASA homepage, for example. But now people use the internet for all matter and all kinds of things within their lives as well. And I believe that such an era will also come for space.
さて皆さんご待望のゴーンさんの話をしましょうか。
And so I believe you've all been waiting, but perhaps last I will speak a little bit about Mr. Gon.
僕は検察官じゃないので彼の、彼のなんかその容疑、とか実際やったことに関して、の情報はほとんど持ってませんので、彼が本当に有罪なのか無罪なのかっていうのは分かりません。
So first of all, I am not a prosecutor. Therefore, in regards to the charges against him or the related facts and so on, I'm not able to say whether he's guilty or not.
ただ今回の件は明らかに言えることは、新しく始まった司法取引制度を検察が使いたくて、その使いたい一番最初のでっかい案件として、日産から持ち込まれたであろうカロルス・ゴーン氏の案件を使ったんだろうなというふうに思いました。
However, one thing I think can be clearly said is looking at the newly introduced system of the plea bargains here in Japan. I think that the prosecutors really wanted a case to try this out on, and this Nissan case is really a test case for the plea bargaining.
で、司法取引は実は本当に前回の司法制度改革から、導入された制度なんですけれども、欧米諸国の司法取引制度と大きく違うところは、主犯格の人は司法取引制度を使えないんですけど、共犯者の人は使えるという、片側だけが使える制度になっています。
And one of the significant differences in regards to this plea bargaining system, which was introduced in the last round of judicial reforms in Japan, a big difference between in other Western countries, for example, is who this can be applicable to, and the fact that it is also applicable to certain conspirators in the case, or people who are seen as well collaborators in the case, but only on one particular side.
なので、主犯格の人も使えるので、例えばですよ。皆さんおそらくご存知だと思うんですけど、ウルフ・オブ・ウォール・ストリートっていう、映画があって、主人公、実在の人物なんですけれども、彼の、刑期はその司法取引制度を使ったおかげで2年6ヶ月だったんですね。
And so one example of this, you're probably all familiar with The Wolf of Wall Street. This was of course the movie, but the main character was based on a real person. And as a result of using the plea bargain system, he was in prison for 2 years and 6 months.
ちなみに僕も2年6ヶ月です。
And I was also 2 years and 6 months.
あの僕も映画見ましたけど、あれでに俺と一緒かってびっくりしましたね。
And so I saw that film as well, and looking at that and thinking, well, he's in prison for the same time as me. I was very surprised.
僕も日本にああいう司法取引制度があったら利用してたと思います。
And I think if such a plea bargain system had existed in Japan, I would have used it.
で、カルロス・ゴーン氏の話に戻ると、僕はこの司法取引制度が非常に危険だということで、衆議院の法務委員会にも証人として出席して、この制度の導入に反対だという意見を表明したんですけれども、それぐらい危険な制度で、つまりカルロス・ゴーンさんは部下の日産の方々から、ゴーンが全部悪いっていうふうに言って、他の人たちはこう起訴すら、逮捕も起訴もされなかったりとかしたわけですけど、ゴーンさんは彼らの証言を受けて、司法取引を使ったりとかして、例えば妥協をするとかそういったことが一切できずに、一方的に追い詰められるだけになってます。
And so, to go back to the case of Mr. Gon, for example, well, I think that this plea bargaining system is something very dangerous. At the time of its introduction, I actually stood as a witness in the Diet to express my opposition to this from my experience as well. Really, this is how serious and how dangerous I think this system is. In the case of Mr. Carlos Gon, for example, well, his juniors within Nissan can say everything was his fault as well. And they are not even indicted or arrested in regards to this case as well. So therefore, there was not even an opportunity for, well, compromise and so on the part of Mr. Gon in relation to that.
で、今後の予測なんですけれども、すべて無罪にならない限りは、 かなり、まあ、有罪判決が出たとするとかなり厳しい判決が出るであろうと。でまだ裁判も始まってませんので、おそらく始まるのは 今年の末から来年にかけて、最初の判決が出るのに、まあ、これか今から1年半から2年ぐらいかかるだろうと。で当然その後、高裁最高裁と争うでしょうから、そうするともうこれから 7,8 年はかかるだろうなと。でもしそこで有罪判決が出るとすると、まあ、5年は下らないだろうなと思いますので、うん、まあ、彼がもし有罪判決を受けたとしたら出てくるのは15年以上先、彼今60何歳ですかね、だからもう80歳近くなってしまうであろうと。で、まあ、それまで気力が持つかどうか、まあ、他人事ながら心配ではありますね。
And so to well predict what I would see as happening from now as well, unless of course he is found completely innocent on all charges. If he is to be found guilty, I think that there will be rather a severe verdict coming. The court case has not started yet. I think it will be starting around the end of this year or sometime into next year. But if we consider that it will probably be a year and a half to 2 years until the verdict, and then from there it will go into likely appeal in the High or Supreme Courts from there as well. So I would estimate this would be about 7 to 8 years for this process from now. If he is found guilty, I don't think that the verdict will be giving him imprisonment of 5 years and so on. I think it would be more in the scope of 15 years or more, considering the situation. So if we think about the fact that he's in his 60s now, he would be in his 80s by the time he would be released. And of course, it's not up to me, but I am rather, well, concerned about this.
Hori-san has to leave, but Inagawa-san has kindly agreed to stay on for some more questions. Before you go, Hori-san, we'd like to present you with a free membership for 1 year.
Wow, thank you.
Come to the FCCJ. Please, please come along.
Okay.
Yes. Thanks very much for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. So we'll continue now with more questions, if you have them, for Inagawa-san.
Perhaps we should close and then have individual questions.
I'm sorry?
I think we should close the overall and have just individual questions if anybody wants to approach him.
Okay. Oh, yes. Because of the time for the room, I'm sorry, we have to close. So if you'd like to come up and ask some questions personally, please do.